Long time, brother. How are you?
Good to see you.
Good to see you as well.
Good to have you here in the car for the second time,
I guess. Yeah, I know. Well, what a unbelievable, beautiful car this is. Brings back memories of home. And yeah. But here we are in beautiful Holland.
Did you have such a car, or family, did they own such a car?
I think the closest thing I came to a Challenger was I had a 1969 Plymouth Fury 3, which was super cherry. It was this kind of dull lime green badass car, but what a beautiful car.
It was kind of sleeper in a big engine.
Huge, just one of those ones that just floats over bumps and yeah, but it was a beautiful car. Unfortunately, I had to get rid of it. I moved up to a part of town where it's not so good on classic cars, so just because of the dirt and the desert and whatnot. But yeah.
Not because they steal cars or something like that.
Yeah, not because they steal cars, just because it's a really rough terrain where I live. So yeah. It's more of a truck type of
Unpaved roads. Terrain.
Yeah, unpaved roads.
Oh my God.
Unpaved roads, yeah.
I was there in America with this car on unpaved roads as well. It's a hell.
Yeah.
And you have this big crown, it's called, I believe, in roads. The middle of the road, it's high and slight.
Yeah. I'm well aware of those, but this is a beauty.
That was the first reincarnation attempt of Kyuss that you did.
Yeah,
it was for Roadburn.
Yeah. You know, those were. It was a great introduction to my solo project. I had been out of the kind of the musical mix for quite a few years, and I wanted to get back into it. So, Garcia Plays Kyuss was more of me trying to spread the word about what was about to happen, which was my solo career.
Okay, it was a kind of vehicle.
Yeah, it was the conduit. It was the vehicle. It was the introduction. It definitely served its purpose.
Yeah, definitely. Because otherwise, there wouldn't be an acoustic tour or other things that followed up.
That's right. Well, you know, unfortunately. What happened was that during Garcia, when I did the Garcia Plays Kyuss piece, I ran into Brent Bjork, and you know we got together, and then I didn't expect that to happen. As me really wanting to get back in the studio and recording with Brent, and so my solo project. Took a yet another backseat to a project, which was, you know, Kyuss Lives, which eventually turned into Vista Chino, and so again, the solo thing got put on hold, but we fulfilled our obligations with Vista Chino, and we
it felt like an obligation.
Well, no, it's just we wanted to, but eventually it turned into, you know, us signing a contract with Napalm, so we really had to, we weren't forced to go in the studio or anything like that. We all wanted to be there, but we were contractually obligated to give them a record. So we did that, and you know, here I am with yet another different venture of
yeah, because you know, what the link with the car I mentioned earlier in 2002, it was with Hermano. Mm-hmm. It was another project, and then
yeah, you
see,
know,
is it still going on? You have a lot of project, and are they continuous, or they stop and you move to another project, or are they all open?
Yeah, I get that a lot, Roland, you know. And you know, there are no set rules for at least for me as a singer, and you know, if I want to play in 50 different bands, it's my God-given right to do that. You know, people say, well, you're watering yourself down. Why are you fucking doing this? Why are you, you're playing in 10 different bands. Well, I'll play in any goddamn band I want to play in, you know.
So you're not obliged by forced by a record company.
Absolutely not.
You can do whatever you want.
And I do whatever I feel, you know, and I say this all the time. If there's a rule book set on singers, that this is what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to stay in this band, and you're supposed to do this, and you're supposed to do that. Well, and you're watering yourself down I don't play by that rule book. I threw that rule book out a long time ago, and it's just something that I get bored easily, and I love challenges. So the next challenge is, you know, I wanted to do something acoustic. I think that me playing with Robbie Krieger from The Doors kind of launched this kind of acoustic thing. On my first solo record, I do an acoustic track with him called Her Bullets Energy, a song that I wrote, and Dandy Brown helped co-write with me. The other bass player for Armando, he helped me kind of finish up this track that I did when I was 18 years old. And lo and behold, Robbie Krieger decided that you know, he would play on it with the help of one of my producers, Harper Hogg. And I think that was the conduit to. You know, me doing this acoustic tour, you know, and this is my third acoustic tour. I'm in love with it.
Yeah,
I like the intimacy. I like the it being stripped down. One vocal, one guitar.
It's naked.
It's stripped down, and it's exposing ourselves in a way that, you know, we've never been. You know, we've never, you know, presented music this way before.
No.
And it was the key thing was, is that it was a challenge. I like being challenged by song, by music, and you know, too, I enjoy still being up on stage. I enjoy performing, and to have it be in this intimate setting where there's only one singer, one guitar, nothing else, no piano,
no
effects,
electric guitars.
No electric guitars. It's just very acoustic. So we're doing a few, you know, Kyuss songs. We even threw in one Vista Chino song, and of course a lot of stuff that Ehren and I have written together. That makes up, you know, the body of the set.
I'm sorry, today we have a friend Unfortunately, I think we better take the plug out.
I was thinking, what was that fucking
smell? Oh, don't stand it, Jim.
What did you do, Gigi? Did you try to turn it on?
Yeah.
Well,
did I say not to turn it on?
No. Oh, no, I mean, this
is... I think it's on fire, dude, look. It's still fucking smoking. Let's see if I can.
Chris, tell him this thing is. Tell him where the fire is in this video game. Tell him to bring a fire extinguisher.
I have some outside noise, but way too hot. It feels like Morongo Valley.
It feels like the desert. As a matter of fact, it's probably close to like 95 degrees there, from what Wendy tells me. So
that's already in March. That's. Way soon. What kind of temperatures is it over there in August? Because I drove there early October,
mm-hmm.
and it was perhaps 19 degrees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What will it be over there in July or August?
Oh yeah, it'll get anywhere from 100 to 120, but it averages about 110, somewhere around there during the summer months.
So Kyuss on like 100 degrees. That comes directly from that.
I think that was a direct result of where we lived. Absolutely, but
because that's what some things I wondered, like song titles, White Water. When I drove from 29 Palms mm-hmm. along Morongo Valley, and I had to turn the I-10 to Palm Desert, and there was White Water.
Yeah.
Fine. Is it the White Water from the song, or is there no reference to that or link to that?
I think there was a direct reference to that song. I think that when Josh and Brent wrote that song, mm-hmm. I think that's what they had in mind. You know, it's no.
For us. No, absolutely. It's his car is as old as you, I believe. Perfect. I hope that you don't sound like this when you move. Okay, sorry.
So you know. I think that when Josh and Brent wrote that song, I think that, you know, it's no mystery that we were very, very proud of where we came from, you know, and we championed where we live, you know, and we were very proud of it, and it was no joke that we were serious about where we were from. It was from the desert. We didn't want to be from a big city, you know, and we weren't really.
So Welcome to Sky Valley, it was also a kind of tribute to a very small community near Palm Desert.
Agreed. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You know,
we started with the picture, and then came the album title. Or did you already have the album title? I thought, well, we go have take a picture there on the Dylan Road.
I think that when at least when Brent presented the possible name title of going Sky Valley, it made perfect sense. You know, mm-hmm. it absolutely made perfect sense. Just like, you know, when he presented the name to me, the band Vista Chino, that's a street in Palm Springs that stretches from Cathedral City to Palm Springs. Mm-hmm. So, you know, again, it's something that, you know, we're I think that I'm certainly proud of, and I still live in the desert. I live in the desert full time.
Never had the urge to move to another place?
Never had the urge to move to another place. I once moved to Los Angeles for an opportunity, and I immediately regretted the decision, but I fulfilled my obligation for this company for about a year, and then I moved directly back to my home. I kept my home in Morongo Valley
to Carruthers.
And it was just I couldn't take it. I couldn't take it, couldn't handle it, and there's a certain level of, you know, being in low gear in the desert versus being in high gear up in Los Angeles.
It's too hot to be in high gear.
It's like LA is, you know, you're just wanting to, if there's intensity and your blood pressure goes up, at least my blood pressure goes up. And then when you come down through Whitewater and you go, you know, down to the desert and you pass all the windmills, you just have this a relaxed feeling. It's just more laxed out. I was driving just a mess.
Bombay Beach.
Yeah,
that's
Bombay Beach.
That's a weird
place. Yeah,
you were there as well for the shoot, or
I was there as well for the shoot.
Okay.
Yeah. But you know that place is, believe it or not, it's cleaned up a lot.
It is.
The Bombay Beach. Well, actually,
I was
Bombay
there five years ago, and it was creepy, man.
It's cleaned up.
Yeah.
A lot.
I was happy to drive in a fast car because I looked for a way to get out if the inhabitants would get after me.
Yeah, exactly. The inhabitants, that's a good way of putting it.
It looked like a kind of zombies. They were sitting in on the couch in front of their houses, looking drunk, weird, following me in a car. So, and I saw your video. Well, you were there to shoot the video over there, but at that time it was already cleaned out.
Yeah, at that time, that was mild. That was mild to when it used to be. I mean, back in the early 90s, that it was deserted, really. It was all underwater. And that's, Bombay Beach is actually the cover for And the Circus Leaves Town. It's underwater. That's Bombay Beach.
Because, well, you know about my tour through America with this car, and I was looking for some Kyuss-related stuff, and I found Salvation Mountain, where the circus leaves town, where he was sitting on this concrete block. But I didn't find the pool, and I didn't find the caravans, the mobile homes in water.
Yeah.
But now I understand why. There was no water anymore.
That's right. They cleaned it up. As a matter of fact, it was me and Renee Reeder, Scott Reeder's wife. We took a drive out there, And then we were just hanging out. We were partying and hanging out and having a good time and whatnot. And back then we were real tight, me and Scotty and Renee and whatnot. But Renee and I, we took a drive out there and we actually found that place. And that eventually became the cover for...
You took the picture? Or
no, it was... No, once we found it, we went back and we told Scott and Josh. And eventually they made it out there and it made perfect sense to take that picture and then that be the cover of the record. So so I've been going out there ever since, you know, really ever since I was a kid. Ever since I can remember, you know, I wasn't born in the California desert. I'm originally from Arizona, a small little town called San Manuel, but I never remember living there. I only remember growing up in Indio. So I've lived from, you know, in the Coachella Valley my entire life. So I'd been going out there, and there's a lot of great little fishing holes out there.
All the fish are dead in the Salton Sea.
I've fished in the Salton Sea and never caught anything, but you know, it's...
Just grab a dead fish.
But there are other freshwater fishing holes around that area when I was a kid.
Okay.
It was legal, and you can go out there, and you can go fish, and go out there with the trailer and my mom, and then they have this place called the American Canal. So, you know, the Coachella Valley is a big agricultural place, you know, especially out in, you know, Yucca and Thermal and Mecca and whatnot. So, you know, there's no water anywhere. So where do you get the water? You get it from the Colorado River. So
that's
at the border of California and Arizona. That forms the border, you know. And so basically what happens is it forms part of the border anyway. Basically, they dug this canal called the American Canal, and it goes all the way from the Colorado River all the way to this little reservoir called Lake Cahuilla, which is a man-made lake. And all the agricultural get their water from you know, the majority of from this source. But the American Canal, the Colorado to Lake Cahuilla, that was all mud bottoms. It's all concreted in now, but back in the day, it was all mud bottoms. It was like a river in the middle of the desert. So it was great fishing, some of the best catfishing ever. So we used to go out there and not only fish, but there's a road that goes along the canal, at least the part that's concreted in, and we used to took a rope up to a surfboard and pull, you know, with a truck, and then I'd be on the surfboard pulling, so I'd be surfing the canal. So some of the things that we did as a kid growing up out there was... That's pretty cool.
So you're a surfer, dude.
You know, I was only 2 hours away from 2 hours away from Newport Beach in Huntington, so it wasn't uncommon that you know a bunch of us kids would go out there and you know, try our hand at surfing or for me, I love to body surf.
With boogie boards or something.
No, we could do the boogie board as well, but body surfing is just you and a pair of fins and that's it.
And if you try and do it for free,
musicians that seem to live all over there.
For me, no.
Okay.
For me, I don't run into those guys. It's not like we, you know, go.
There's not one bar and everybody meets inside.
It's not like we go and hang out and, you know, have barbecue or stuff like that. I mean, I think between, you know, I'm not sure what they're doing, but my schedule is mostly surrounded about my family. So as far as me hanging out with anybody,
except Ehren,
it's a rarity that I get out at all, because I want to be around my best friend. I want to be around my kids, you know, my best friend being my wife. So we don't get out much, and we like it that way. Family is very, very important to both Wendy and I, and we like being around each other. We're in love with each other, and we're friends. So that's, you know, nice. we do our thing, and Marshall and Madison, they're involved in our everyday life. I think my daughter's a little, she's 13, and she's going through her thing, and she's more interested in you know, her friends and her music,
but they know that their father is a rock musician. They realize it. I think Marshall might be too young for that to understand.
They realize it, but they're very, very unimpressed with anything in the outside world.
I thought I'm not impressed with you as a rock musician.
Yeah, you know, and that I love that about them. You know, I absolutely adore it. You know, people will say, you know, they ask me, well, what do your kids listen to? And well, my daughter listens to stuff a 13-year-old listens to. She's not one of those girls that have fallen in love with Led Zeppelin yet. She listens to Taylor Swift. So if, goddamn it, if my daughter wants to listen to Taylor Swift and she wants me to turn it up, I'm gonna turn it up. Absolutely, you know. And I do that because I love her. And whatever path she wants to go down as far as music is concerned, I will nurture that 100%. I will obviously, you know, expose her to some other types of music. 100%, I will. Whether she grasps onto it, you know, now or later, you know, that's totally up to her. But it's something that I give them the freedom to like what they want to like, you know. And all I can do is nurture that natural path, and just try to be a good father as much as I can. I'm not gonna force them into the music industry by any means. As a matter of fact, I will most likely deter them from this. But if they want to go down that path and they want to, you know, play guitar or drums or anything like that, that I will nurture. I think that Madison has a little love for drums. I think that she's, you know, I think she wanted to go down that path, and you never know, she still might. Marshall, he is more into school right now. He's really into his math. He's really into spelling. He's a very, very smart boy. And he's, as a matter of fact, he's at the top of his class, scholastically. And that's something that I want, that my kids' education is really very, very, very important to me.
Are there any education opportunities over there? Because it seems like a very isolated place.
You know, the schools in California are not the best, the public school system. So therefore, my son doesn't go to a public school. He goes to a private school, and for good reason.
And that's in the neighborhood.
It's in Palm Springs. So that's important. And as well as, but on the flip side of the coin, where my daughter lives with her mother in Wisconsin, the school system is much different. The public school system, it's very, very, very good. It's a great school system. So we don't have to be so aggressive when it comes to her education, as long as she keeps her grades up. Yeah. But
would that be a reason for you to leave Marunda family if Marshall getting older, to give him the opportunity to go to a better school, if he wants to go to high school, university, or is that
100%? Absolutely. That, again, and I've never really talked about this in any type of interview at all, but it's something that it's a thing with me. That's their education. It's very important to me. It's at the top of my list when it comes to being a father, is to make sure my kids get a good education. And that's it's important. And you know, although Marshall is you know still very young, he's only in second grade. It's important to me that he knows that his dad cares about that.
Yeah.
It looks like this one just went out. This guy right here just went out. Recent travel ban and for all the electronics from these certain selected countries. I'm not going to get political, but there's somebody that was complaining about, oh, my kids are not going to have going to be able to use their tablet. Well, here's a how about this? How about you open a fucking book and read to your kids, or better yet, have them read to you? How's that? Why don't you take them off the goddamn tablet for a moment and open a paperback. Here's a thought. You know, that's might be step number one if the electronics are that big a part of someone's life. And I certainly I feel strongly about that.
So it's not 8 hours television on in the house of the Garcias?
Very rarely is the TV on, and when it's on, when he's allowed to watch it, he likes a SpongeBob, you know, and that's okay with me. Yeah. That's perfectly fine by me.
Yeah.
But now, do you have kids?
No, you know, you asked. Well, you know, perhaps you forgot. Last time you played in Harlem.
Yes.
Harlem. I was there with my wife, Natasha, and you asked, do you have kids? No, we don't have kids. And then you almost convinced us to take kids.
I did forget about that, and I apologize to you, Roland, but
you meet more people than I guess, with this kind of life.
Well, it's just, you know, I think that I'm... when I'm out here on the road, I always look for a little bit of a common denominator of having a conversation with another dad about kids and about family life but you're married,
sure.
You know what it's like, and
I know what it's like to have not too much time, and I don't have kids, so I have spare time to do things like this, but I can imagine when you have and kids and a musical career and a normal career.
Mm-hmm.
That's a lot.
It's a lot. It's a lot.
You said the spare time that you don't use for your family, you use with Ehren to produce music. He lives in the neighborhood as well.
Yeah, in Palm Springs.
Ah, okay. So it's not a long travel time.
No, I could be at his rehearsal studio in 20 minutes from my house.
By car?
Yeah, by car.
What kind of car do you drive? If it's secret, then don't tell me.
It's
Brian's.
Yeah, people would be surprised. But you know, again, I would love to be able to drive, you know, a 69 Roadrunner. You know, I'd love to be able to drive a 69 El Camino, but where I live, I can't do it because they're unpaved and they're rocky and they wash out, and I live literally in the middle of the desert. We have an SUV and we have a normal family car that we drive, but it's more of a necessity that we have an SUV versus 69 El Camino, because you can hear the bolts unrattling and unscrewing themselves going up a road, and I just can't have it.
Especially with these kind of cars.
Exactly. Exactly. So, you know, Wendy really wants to move down to the lower desert.
What's the lower desert?
I'm sorry?
What is the lower desert?
So we're up in the high desert, up in Morongo, so the low desert's Palm Springs, Rancho Mirage.
Okay.
So we want to either move to Rancho Mirage or to Palm Springs. Hopefully eventually, and you know, I want to make my wife happy. Eventually we'll get down there, but not yet.
You know, this sounds great. Should I take you on the road?
There,
of course.
All right. Good.
Also,
full files on Ferry.
Chris, get his number. Get his number and give us contact information.
I noticed during the instrumental, you heard it was feeding back a little, and I think it might have turned me down a bit.
Yeah, just... Right.
But the fact that you remember that from soundcheck,
okay.
Thank
Excellent.
You so much, dude. It was a great show.
Excellent work.
Appreciate the hard work.
So, wait, guys, let me just wait.
I gave you a love from the cult
yes.
a couple of months ago, because I want to get rid of my vinyl collection. And recently I got a box full of albums from the uncle of Natasha. He moved to Greece and he left his record collection with us. But we don't have a record player. And I was going through the albums and I saw one. And we immediately said to each other, this one is for John.
Oh.
So, because you did an interview with the Quietus a couple of months, years ago, about your 15 or 10 favorite albums. Well, Love of the Cult was one of them.
Yes.
This.
Ah, the electric. Ah, so love it. One of my all-time favorite records as well. Absolutely, by far, one of my all-time favorite records. This is the record the first record that Rick Rubin had done for the Cult.
Yeah, different sounds.
Totally. So they went from Love. That was produced by Steve Brown, not Dandy Brown.
But then they
jumped up. I remember the first time I heard this record. It was my sophomore year at Palm Desert High School in my English class. And Mr. Haggerty was teaching, and there was this girl by the name of Maggie Martin that was sitting right in front of me. And she goes, "Did you hear the new Cult record?" I said, "You're out of your mind. There's no new Cult record out." And she goes, "I got it. I just got it yesterday." And I said, "Fucking hand it over."
Yeah.
So I listened to it and I thought, how did the Cult go from the Cult Love to the Cult Electric? And it was just a totally different sound. I mean, they went from being this psychedelic kind of
gothic like
new wave goth. New wave kind of.
And I had big troubles with electric the first time. I was very.
I had big troubles with it as well.
Yeah, because you know the Maynard sessions.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, there, Billy Duffy has his old sounds.
Yes, with these songs.
These songs.
Yes, yeah. The Maynard sessions. I got the box set. There's a whole box set, and I've got it. But you know, to hear Love Removal Machine like the Love
session.
Yeah, like Love,
yeah.
And even Electric Ocean and
yep.
and you know all of these, the majority of these songs, it's what a trip, you
yep.
know
yep.
what a trip this was.
Have you ever met him, Ian Ashbury? I know you're.
I've met Ian Ashbury. Yes, I've met him, and you know, it's no. Thank you for this, by the way, Roland. That's very kind.
Well, thank
you. That's very, very, very kind.
Natasha. Thank Carl.
And Natasha, thank you very much. Okay. You know, it means a lot, and I appreciate it, and it's always nice seeing you, and yeah.
Well, likewise. To finish, what's the next challenge?
You know, next challenge is Ehren and I, after we're going to do an electric record. Okay. I'm contractually obligated to do another electric record, but I'm looking beyond that. I'm always about a year and a half or a year to a year and a half in front of my schedule. I already know what I'm going to be doing next year, up until really the end of next year. Ehren and I were thinking about doing a blues record.
Whoa.
Of strictly all blues covers. So
Robert Johnson, whatever.
Exactly. So we're thinking about doing that. I don't know if it's a possibility. I mean, you have a Mexican and a Jewish kid trying to do blues. It doesn't sound like a right combination. But you know, he's a fan of music. I'm still a fan of music, and you know, that to me is a challenge to do like a strictly blues record. We'll see what happens.
Okay, well, good luck with this next challenge, and let's get Ehren.
Thank you.
Coming to you from Roland's wonderful, beautiful, classic Challenger. This is Ehren Groban. I'm John Garcia. The song is called Don't Even Think About It. Play the concert in this car tonight?
Can we roll it up onto the fucking stage?
That's what we need to do.
Oh,
cheers,
man.
Roland. Thank you, brother. Awesome.
Thank you, guys.
Cheers. Let's take this baby for a spin.
All right, let's go for a drive, Roland.
Yeah.
All right.
It's going to make some noise behind. That's the fuel pump, so don't be scary. It's supposed to sound like that. That sound.
Oh, my God.
Hey, it's a huge engine. It's in the 470 cubic inch.
470?
It's souped up. It's a stroked 400.
man.
I can drive like this.
Woo! That's powerful. Damn. Damn, you can feel that.
Enjoy the last 2 miles. We done?